Hey everyone, it's Melody with Design by Melody. I'm actually here today with a question and answer video plus some updates for my what I plan to do for 2017. Now, I didn't do like a goals video or anything like that, but this kind of tells you what I plan to do this year. So I'm going to answer a couple questions first that I've gotten here recently on my YouTube channel, and then I'm also going to tell you what's coming up, and then also some updates. So a couple questions. Well, first let me tell you a little bit about myself. Now, if you guys have watched for a while, you already know a lot of this, but just to kind of give you an idea, I live in North Carolina with my family. I am married. I've been married for over 10 years now, and we have a 6-year-old son. He just turned 6 in December. His name is Kaylin, and my husband's name is Ernest. So we live in North Carolina. I've only been scrapbooking since Kaylin was about 3 years old, four, 2 years old, two? 2013, I think, is when I started. So, I guess that was like 3.5 years ago. And I first originally started scrapbooking really through card making. So I was making cards, but I have two sisters. I have an older sister and a younger sister. My older sister is 3 years older than me, and then I have a younger sister that's 5 years younger than me. And they really got into card making at one point. And so they kind of pulled me into it, and I just thought the cards that they were making were really cute. And so I just kind of started doing a little bit of card making. It didn't take me long at all to transition to scrapbooking, though. I ended up looking online and finding process videos for cards and came across Christina Warner and ended up coming across Marcy Tiera. That was really my first person that I came across on YouTube, and she totally inspired me to try scrapbooking. So I very quickly just dove right into scrapbooking and took it, full force. And the way I started with the Studio Calico subscription, and I asked for it for my birthday. My husband signed me up for it in July that year, and I just started scrapbooking. I started with those kits and really started to expand my stash of supplies from there. Now, I had some stuff in my stash, of course, already because I was making cards already, and I'm kind of a crafty person, so I had a lot of just basic craft supplies anyways. And then it just kind of expanded and blew up from there. I pretty quickly after I started doing regular 12 by 12 traditional scrapbooking, I really got into Project Life. I think it was like within a few months, like maybe 2 or 3 months from starting scrapbooking. And I have actually been recording process videos from the very, very beginning. And this kind of answers one of the questions, the first question, which is how did you get into video and some of the tips and some tips for videos on YouTube? So I started scrapbooking because of YouTube videos. It started with cards from my sisters, but the whole reason I transitioned to scrapbooking was because of the inspiration that my sisters gave me, but also from YouTube. And it just seemed like something that would be so much fun to do. And I really thought like the idea of scrapbooking for my son and my family. So he was very young at the time, and I wanted to be able to remember some of the things that were going on at the time and so I could share with him. So for instance, my dad was really sick and he ended up dying a couple years ago, but I have pictures of Kaylin, my son, my dad holding him when he was a baby and feeding him and things like that. So those are the type of photos that I really wanted to get preserved in some way, not just on my computer or on a hard drive somewhere, but like somewhere that you could actually flip through an album. So that's how I really got started. And because I was so into watching YouTube videos, especially Marcy Tiera, now it quickly expanded to many, many, many other people, but with her primarily, she was my first person really that I followed. I really loved her videos, and so I just thought, well, what the heck? I had done a couple process videos for cards, and so it wasn't really that different to do a process video for a layout. Now, I started out very basic. I started with a camera on a tripod, and eventually now I actually record with my iPad, which is what you are on right now. And I have it mounted on kind of an arm that's attached to my table. I've done a craft room tour before, and you can see that in there. I'll try to remember to link that in the description box below. But I now have upgraded to an over-the-top recording. At first, it was kind of from the side at a weird angle, but then I have quickly figured out how to upgrade to over-the-top recording because that's just better. It's easier for you guys if you're watching from over-the-top. And then I have two daylight lamps on either side, and that's really, I mean, I have basic equipment. I don't have anything fancy. I actually started out originally with the camera on the tripod, and I was using my DSLR camera. Well, actually, my iPad records a lot better than the DSLR camera did, just for space reasons and things like that and ease of use. So that's kind of how I got started. It was very basic. My biggest tip to you is just try a couple things. Don't invest in a lot of really fancy equipment. Try what you have around your house. The lamps that I have the daylight bulbs in are like $5 lamps from Walmart or Target. They're very cheap. And then I just use my basic, my computer. We have a Mac, and so I use iPhoto to do my photo editing, and I use iMovie to put the movies together. So I don't have any fancy software equipment that I use. I just have basic stuff. Now, I do have a microphone. That's just something we actually had. I know not everybody has a microphone, but we just had a microphone. So I use it hooked up to the computer just for sound quality. But you don't even have to do that if you don't want to. There are definitely ways to make videos without having a lot of fancy equipment. I would just say try it. I know a lot of people record on their phones. If you have an updated iPhone, I just happen to like Mac products, Apple products. So if you happen to have like an updated iPhone, like one of the newer versions, the cameras are great on those. Use those. You just have to have enough space to do the recording. I hate when the recording cuts off halfway through and you've lost something. So another big tip is make sure you have enough space on whatever device you're using. Delete any videos that you can before you start recording, because having the video cut off in the middle is one of the most annoying things. It's just frustrating. We have two iPads, and the iPad that I use, I'm the only one that uses it, and I primarily use it for reading books and doing videos and watching YouTube. So as soon as I'm done with a video, I delete everything, all the stuff off of the iPad, so then I free up that space again. So that's kind of question number one. Question number two is, how do I choose my color combinations for my stash kits? Well, I'm a very simple person. I think my brain tries to overcomplicate things, but it doesn't need to be complicated. So I basically choose my color combinations just off of what I see. So I'm a really big fan of navy and gray, and I like to either pair that with pink or lime green or yellow. Just pairing navy and gray with different things is really pretty. So sometimes I'll just go with what I think looks good. Just, I haven't scrapbooked with navy in a while, or I've been scrapbooking with more brown tone products. So I may go, I want a scrapbook with black and white products or something like that. So I usually just go with whatever I feel like it. Sometimes it's product focused. So if I have a, let's say I have a pack of stickers. Let's just see here. See if I can find something offhand. Let's say I just have something that I want to use up. So let's just say I have like this package. These are Pink Fresh Studio Acetate Die Cut Words. So I have a couple left. But let's say I have this and I just really like these products, so I want to go ahead and use them. I'll pull from colors in here. Or let's say that I have a collection that I just love the papers. So I'll take those papers and I'll pull three colors. I try to shoot for three. Sometimes a fourth color comes in there, but I really try to base it around three colors just because it's a lot easier. If you start adding colors, your kit starts to grow and grow and grow, and it comes a little out of control. As you can see, my stash kit number two for 2017 is quite large. So that's kind of what happened. And then sometimes it's just, I see somebody else did a layout or a card or something that I thought was just beautiful, and I'll pick a couple of colors from there and then go with it. So that's, there's no real like fancy way that I pick. It's just whatever I think looks good. Or if there's a certain product that I want to use. All right, how do I print smaller pictures? Now, I only really order my pictures once or twice a year, and I know that seems crazy, but I sit down and I do a big planning session for what I want to scrapbook, and I do all of the pictures for it. This is like a very simple process, but I have all my memorabilia divided by month, and I have these envelopes with the date, the month, and the year, and I put as many memorabilia pieces as I can in here, and whatever doesn't fit, I just clip to it. And then when it gets to a point to where I'm out of photos to scrapbook, I will sit down at my computer, I will take these, and I'll pull up my iPhotos and I'll sort it by date. And so I'll pretty much just take every photo. So like for July of 2015, I took every photo from July 1st to the end of July, July 31st of 2015. And I look through them and I go, okay, I want this picture, I want this picture, I want this picture. Oh, this picture's nothing. Or I have five of this pictures from the same thing. And I'll just kind of write down what I have. And then I'll look at all the photos that I have and I'll plan out layouts. Now, I don't do weekly project life spreads. If you have not watched my channel or you haven't seen an album flip through, I usually will do divided page projectors, one at the very beginning of the month, and then I'll do one at the very end of the month, and then I'll put whatever I want in between. I have a divider that labels each month. And so I'll put anything else that I want in between those two project life pages, whether it's 12 by 12 layouts, whether it's more divided page protectors that may document an event that has a ton of photos, or if I didn't really have anything special go on that much month, but I have a lot of really random photos, I'll do another project life page in between. So as long as I have my beginning of the month with my month title card, I have the divider that has the month labeled at the top, and then I have whatever other pages I want, and then an ending page, project life page. That's how I do my albums. So I'll look at all the photos that I took that month and I'll go, okay, well, are any of these super special that I want a 12 by 12 layout on? And if they are, I'll go ahead and, you know, set those aside just for 12 by 12 layouts. And then I take the rest of the photos that I want in my album, but maybe don't need a 12 by 12 page, and I'll just divide them across page protectors. You just have to make sure, at least for me, I make sure that I have even numbers of pages, because I want there to still be a beginning page and an ending page without having to like end on the front, on the back side of a page, or something like that. I want one whole month sandwiched together. So that's how I do it. Now, and this really kind of fits into, this is really kind of answers two questions, because the next question is, how do you decide which pictures you're going to add to a project life page and which ones are going to be a full layout? So that's what I just kind of described. Now, once I have all of my leftover pictures that are not going to be 12 by 12s, then I start looking at, okay, well, how many pictures do I have left? Do I want to put any of them in a 3x4 pocket? Do I want to put multiple ones on a 4x6 pocket? I don't typically use smaller photos on my 12 by 12 pages. Usually I either use a 4x6, or I'll take a 4x6 and cut it down to like a 4x4. I don't typically print smaller than that photos to put on my 12 by 12 pages. I usually reserve those for the larger photos. But for the smaller ones, because I only order like once a year or something like that, the last time I ordered enough photos to do Project Life that had smaller photos, I used Snapfish, and they used to have a collage option for you. Now, I don't know if it's still there. I checked about September and it was not back yet. They updated their site and they took away the collage printing, but they said they were bringing it back, so I just haven't seen if it's been back yet. I haven't tried, but I know there are a lot of other photo programs that'll let you do a collage print. Basically, what you want to do is you want to take a 4x6 photo and make it a collage. Now, I just make it a collage with two photos. So I have two 3x4 photos, roughly 3x4 photos on top of that 4x6. So I think PicMonkey, you can do it. There's a lot of different ones. Just Google like collage photo printing or something like that, and you'll be able to do it. So like I said, I just basically print them to where there's two to a 4x6, and then I cut it apart when I get it. And I always do a white border. You can have the photos to where they butt up right next to each other, but I choose to do a white border because I like having the white border around them. So I hope that answers that question. And these are my planning sheets, by the way. And then right here, so that it's easy for me to find, I mark off whatever pages I have done. And so like this one, I only have one more Project Life page to do, and it's page number 3, which is this one. And then I'll be done with this month, and I just throw it away when I'm done with it. So the last question is, how do you make flip pockets? Now, I got a couple questions about this, and then I had a couple people ask how I make my custom page protectors. So I decided to do a couple tutorial videos for you guys. So the first one is how to make custom size page protectors, and that's things like this. Because I don't really typically buy inserts, I really just buy the Design A page protectors, and I buy 12 by 12 pages, but I have a ton of random sized, random design Project Life pages that I've picked up mostly at Tuesday morning, or they were given to me by people. So I keep every single page protector I have. I have a ton of them that are those old ones that were from the post bound scrapbook pages, scrapbook albums that I don't use. I had a ton of page protectors that came out of those. Excuse me. So I keep all those, and I use those page protectors to cut down into the custom size pages that I want. So the tutorial that's going up on Thursday the 26th, today is Tuesday the 24th of January, but the one that's going up on Thursday, January 26th, shows you how I make these types of page protectors, and I show a couple different methods of how I do it. For instance, these are sewn down the side. This one doesn't even have I cut this off the corner of a 12 by 12 page, and then I made my own binding here. So I show how I do different things like that. So that is coming up on Thursday the 26th. So I'm not going to explain that right now because there's a whole video dedicated to that. Another question I had was about flip pockets, how I make my flip pockets, and I'll share this with you. So on Sunday, the 29th of January, just a couple days from now, so this next coming Sunday, I'll have this tutorial posted for you. And this is how I do flip pockets in my Project Life. So there are three different ways that I do flip pockets. So I have like a card that's an exposed flip pocket, and it's actually movable. I have one that's an enclosed card, so you can't actually touch it. Like, this is the card yourself. You could touch it. This one is enclosed, but then you still can do the card here. And then this is a side flip pocket, and this is using washi tape to enclose it, but you could also stitch. So then I have a side flip pocket. Now, I don't have a fuse tool, and I don't feel like I have a reason to buy a fuse tool, so I don't have one. So I make all my flip pockets using basic supplies that are in my stash, whether it's a sewing machine or just adhesive or washi tape or whatever. So I have a tutorial going up on Sunday the 29th on how to do all three different of these, three different flip options. I've had a lot of questions about that. So if you like flip pockets, I love interactive elements in my album. So if you like flip pockets and just don't know how to use them, or don't have a fuse tool like I don't have one, then watch that tutorial because you'll be able to see how to do these. And then my last tutorial that I have coming up, and that's going to be Tuesday the 31st of January, is this artwork and project book tutorial. And I go through how I made this, and I actually make another one with you. So this is how I am keeping my son's artwork from school. So this was his preschool year one book, and in the tutorial that's going up on Tuesday the 31st, I have his preschool year two artwork book, and I go through every single step on how I made this book, from organizing the artwork and the projects to photographing, editing the photos, putting the book together, ordering the book, and all of that. So go check that out, because that's a very detailed tutorial on how to do this. I love this because I have massive amounts of artwork from when he was in preschool. He was in 3 years of preschool, and he's in kindergarten now. If I keep going at that rate of keeping all of those supplies and all those pages and stuff, I'm going to have 20 billion Rubbermaid containers full of this stuff by the time he graduates high school, and nobody's going to look through those. So having these books on the shelf with my scrapbook albums, he pulls this out all the time and looks at it and goes, "Hey, mommy, 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 you remember when I made this? This bunny rabbit was so cute," or whatever. So, and it's just a great way to keep it all. I mean, I have all of it, and you can see it, and it's just well preserved. Plus, I have a place to add memorabilia. And then I have a little bit of a story about school. I have his first day photos on here as well. So check that tutorial out, because I show how I make that. And I will do this. My goal is to have one of these done every single year before the next school year starts. So I just did his preschool year two. By the end of February, my goal is to have preschool year three done. And then my goal for having his kindergarten book, he finishes kindergarten in June, and he starts first grade at the end of July. So my goal is to have his kindergarten book done before he starts first grade. So then I don't have I only have the artwork from that year kind of piling up. Now, there are a few pieces that I'm going to keep regardless, and I have one Rubbermaid container that's set aside for that to keep that type of stuff, and I'll keep those indefinitely. But it's only like two or three pieces each year. And then there are a few things that are going into my scrapbook albums, especially like handwriting samples and things like that are going to go actually in my scrapbook album. So there are, I am keeping some things. Don't freak out. I'm not getting rid of everything, but I'm getting rid of like 95% of it. And it's amazing because I feel like this is much more usable and easier to go through than like a Rubbermaid container of just stuff. All right, so those are kind of my tutorials that are coming up. Now, I had a thought to do a couple different tutorials. I thought about recording how I, or showing you guys me going through my photos and kind of planning my pages for the year, and like printing my photos. I thought about doing that. Let me know if that's something you guys are interested in, because if it is, I will do it. I won't do a whole year, but I'll show you like a month. And then also how to print on journaling cards. Now, there are a lot of tutorials on how to do this. And this is not my, that's not something I came up with. These other tutorials are things I figured out on my own. But printing on journaling cards is not something that I came up with. But I'd be happy to share that with you if that's something you guys are interested in. I'll show you how I do it. So let me know if those other tutorials are something that you would like to see. Or if you have other tutorials that you would like to see that I haven't mentioned. I'd be happy to do it. Just let me know in the comment section below. All right, so a couple other updates. My kit review series. I am taking a small break from that so I can kind of finish up a couple projects like these tutorial videos and things like that. And I will be starting that back. I probably won't start it back though till March or April, just because I have so much stuff, so many things I'm trying to finish right now, which I'm sharing with you. I will still have videos up 3 to 4 times a week. Don't worry about that. But I am holding back on the kit review series right now because I just don't have the time to be able to use the kit and review it and have it up for you guys in a timely manner with the other things that I have going on, like the tutorials, for instance, in this Q&A video. But I do have a different way that I'm going to be documenting my kit reviews for you. So originally I had it in a Google document. It was an Excel spreadsheet on Google, on Google Docs. Wow, I can't get that out. Okay. On Google Docs, and you could go up there and you could print it. Well, now it's just so massive, you can't print it, and it's really hard to read and compare. So what I decided to do is have a PDF document. And this is on my blog on the resources and tools page on my blog, which is always active, and it's always linked in the description box below of every video that I do. So what I have is every time that I do a kit review, I will be updating this document. So there's going to be two links. Well, yeah, basically two links. One link to the entire PDF that's completely up to date, and then another link to each kit that I reviewed's page. So like this entire document would be one PDF, but then the pages themselves, like this freckled fawn review. If you wanted to just print that freckled fawn review, there'd be a link to just this page. So if you, for some reason, I don't know that you would, but if you wanted to print my entire thing, each time, each month, you could print just that month's page. Now, this is what it'll look like. Kit review series, designed by Melody, blah, 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 blah. And then I have a contents page where it tells you what kits I've reviewed, and it tells you what type of kit it is. And then you've got the comparison page, and this is pretty much what it was before. However, I added a few things. I added a month reviewed section, so you could tell when I reviewed it. And then I also added a links to the videos. So whenever you're actually seeing this page is when I'm done reviewing that kit, but it'll have links to every single video that I did in relation to this kit. So if you're just looking at this, you can go back and see all the videos that were associated with it. And same thing here. Here's the Stampin' Up! One. And it will have all the links down here. I'm still doing this one, so this one's not done. But this is what it looks like. Now, I've only gotten this far. I have not updated it completely, but I will be going back and adding all of the kits that I did in 2016. I think I ended up doing like 16 or 17 for the year of 2016. So I will add that here, and each kit will have its own page, just like this. So if If using this was helpful for you, I will definitely make sure you check out my blog and the tools and resources and tools page on there to have this. I will keep my Google document up there. I'm not going to take it down, but I'm not going to edit it anymore. So make sure you go to my blog if that's something that you're wanting to see and use. And that will be linked in the description box below of every video as well from now on. Another update. So for 2015, 2016, and 2017, now it's a well-known fact that I'm not up to date on my scrapbooking. As I mentioned, I print my photos every 6 months to a year, and so I'm at least 6 months to a year behind at all times because I just don't print the photos up to date. I have enough of older photos that I want to scrapbook that there's no pressing need for me to print December's photos of 2016 when I still have December of 2015 to finish. So I'll give you an update on 2015. So 2015 is all planned out just like this with my planner pages, and then it has what layouts I need to do. Now I went back and I counted them the other day, and I think I'm down to like 22 pages left of 2015 for me to do, and then I don't have any other photos printed. I have January of 2016, but after that, I don't have any. So my goal by the end of March is to go ahead and have all of 2016 printed and be done with my layouts for 2015, or at least almost done. I post videos 3 to 4 times a week, and I do process videos for 99% of the layouts that I do. There's only the rare occasion that I don't do a process video for one, and sometimes that's if I'm doing a layout for someone else, because I do scrapbooking for other people sometimes as well. So I don't always have process videos, or don't always want to share the process videos for those types of layouts, because they are not for me. They're for someone else, and there's the whole confidentiality and protection and all that stuff. So, but 99% of my layouts have process videos. So if I only have 22 or 23 left, I'll be done with that in no time, especially now that I've done all the tutorial videos and stuff that I had planned out. So 2016 will be printed by the end of March, and then I will be working on that throughout this year. Now, with the rate that I scrapbook, and some months only have 4 layouts, as you can see, I could be caught up with 2016 by pretty quickly in this year. But because I didn't start scrapbooking until 2013, I have a lot of photos from before that I would like to scrapbook. So that's another goal of mine this year, is to start working backwards, not just catching up, because I don't worry about being behind, but I would really like to capture some of those stories from before 2013, like, you know, Kaylin's newborn pictures would be nice to have in my scrapbook. I do have a couple layouts from when I was pregnant, because we had a nice pregnancy photo session and I had printed some photos from that before. But I would like to have some photos of him as a newborn in my albums. I just kind of feel like that would be something I would want to have in there later. And then I also have a couple other albums I'm working on, like an All About Me album. I'm going to be adding to that here. I've got a couple layouts planned for that. And then a family history book that I'm working on. And then I was doing kind of a planner-esque kind of video, I guess you could say, where I was documenting just random daily events or day-to-day types of things in a album. Now, that's kind of taken a back burner for the moment, because I was wanting to do a couple other things, but I will pick that up. And then this year for 2017, I would like to do a December's Traditions album. Now, this is not a December daily, but I do plan to do it in December, where I document some of our December traditions, and then each year I can add to that, to where I, you know, maybe I get 4 traditions documented this year, maybe about like the elf on the shelf, and then going to see Christmas lights, and then, you know, things like that. And then next year I add to it. So it's going to be an album just about December, our December traditions, but it's not specific to one year. It's just kind of, you know, traditionally, what do we do and what things have we added to our traditions list? So that's kind of the plans for the layouts for 2017. And then I already mentioned having the possibly doing a tutorial for printing on journaling cards. Just let me know if that's something you'd like to see. So I think that's it. Oh, I also plan to continue the giveaways this year. I did give away probably about every other month last year. There were a couple months where I had giveaways back to back, but I'm going to continue that. And this first month, we had a Sunshine Stamp Company giveaway. I had purchased a set of stamps to give away, and then the shop owner had given me stamps to give away when I placed that order. So that was a really awesome giveaway for this month. But I plan to continue to to do those giveaways. I don't know exactly what they'll be themed around, but you just stay tuned and you'll find those out. I love giving away things to you guys. I really appreciate all of you guys as my viewers and my subscribers and my supporters. You guys are awesome. And I absolutely love reading all of the comments. I may not respond immediately, but I will respond. I try to respond to every single comment that I get. And I love seeing what you guys create. So if you are not a member of my Facebook group, please make sure you go down in the description box below and click on that link to go to that Facebook group and add yourself, because I would love to have you as part of my group. So I think that finishes it off. Thank you so much for joining me today, and I hope you guys have a great afternoon. All right, bye.